Cross country and biathlon, the long trek through the woods, the icicles on the noses, and all of that. A marvelous thing. Here's Bill.
Miedo trailed the leader by only 3 seconds at the 5K mark. He was 5 seconds behind at 10K. But then, Miedo put on a remarkable charge, a charge that only a man of such awesome strength is capable of. He crashed his poles into the snow. He drove his powerful legs to the finish line. He knew that a gold was within his grasp. When he crossed the finish line, he got a thunderous ovation. His time was posted, 41 minutes, 57 and 64 one-hundredths of a second. The officials were soon to be glad that the timers were that exact, to 1/100th of a second. And here came Wasberg.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
The time, 41, 57, 63. 1/100th of a second. And Wasberg had won the gold medal.
Juha Mieto was too exhausted to raise his head. It was hard to believe that he could lose a gold medal by the length of his nose after 9 miles of racing. We got our first look at head-to-head competition and its mass start in the women's 4x5 relay. The world champion Finns in lane 1 in the middle of the course. The United States in lane 7. Allison Owen Spencer skiing the leadoff lane, to be followed by Beth Paxson, Leslie Bancroft, and Margaret Spencer. Now Allison is just coming into view on the right-hand side of your picture in the white ski suit. Allison Owen Spencer simply out-sprinted the field to the double sets of tracks that marked the course 100 meters down this long straightaway. Allison held that lead for a short time, but eventually it was the surprising team from East Germany that won the gold medal. The East Germans were anchored by pretty Barbara Petzold, who earlier in the games had won a gold medal in the 10-kilometer race. She announced that this was her last Olympics. She was giving up competitive skiing for medical school. What a way to go out. The sport of biathlon became an instant hit with American fans at Lake Placid, who were fascinated with the discipline of two so completely contrasting skills, shooting and cross-country racing. It was a war of nerves on the final leg of the relay between the Russians and the East Germans. East German getting ready to shoot. Olubiev on 13, the East German on 11. One down for the Russian. Two down. Miss on 3. He's got another one. East German has missed the first two, and the Russian has one target remaining. 3 bullets left. He's got it. And now, East German has 3 bullets left to make 3. A clean score could mean that he could catch the Russian in the cross country. Now, 2 to make 2. A miss. The gold was gone. Another miss could cost the silver because the West German team was closing fast. He made it. But one target was still up and all of his bullets were gone. That forced a penalty loop. But at least the silver was saved and the Russians were ecstatic. Olubiev crossed the finish line, giving the Soviets their 4th straight gold medal in this event. Their jubilation was spontaneous. And there was no hiding their emotion. The world's greatest biathlete, Alexander Tikhonov, won his 4th gold medal in the relay. And then he announced his retirement. But if the Russians say goodbye to one superstar, they certainly uncovered another one in these games. His name, Nikolai Zimyatov. In his first Olympics, he already had won 2 gold medals going into the final event, the 50-kilometer marathon. Showing the same magnificent form that won him the gold medal in the 30K, Zimyatov sailed across the finish line, beating the best previous time by more than 3 minutes. Miedo put on a finishing drive that brought cheers from the crowd. As he strode through the gates, he quickly turned and looked at the scoreboard. It confirmed what he knew. He had won the silver for himself and for his country. Bill Koch came in, bone weary, arms at his sides, legs numb. He had finished 13th, the same spot as 4 years ago.
The story of cross-country and biathlon. I suspect that 4 years from now, when we're in Sarajevo, Yugoslavia, we'll be covering even more of it because it really is fascinating and grueling sport. Well, in a minute, we're going to take a look at a slightly different kind of piece because we've had an awful lot of questions and phone calls about how this whole thing was put together by ABC Sport. We'll see it right after this word from your local stations.
Monday, the greatest ever, Elvis.
Any good deals today, Whittington?
Well, my broker says Jack in the Box.
Jack in the Box?
Okay, won't be long now. We'll be going out to the ice stadium. There has been a delay out there occasioned by the fact that so many fantastic things have happened in that stadium since 11 o'clock this morning, starting with the victory of the United States winning the gold medal in ice hockey over Finland 4-3. So we have a couple minutes yet, however. And we're going to take that look we talked about of how ABC Sports put this whole thing together. It really is a fascinating story. Keith Jackson will tell us about it.
When the huge trucks rolled toward the North Country of New York State into the Adirondacks last October, it was the first action phase of some 3.5 years of planning. A massive logistical exercise involving the placement of 109 cameras and the laying of over 72 miles of cable. This whole process overseen by Julie Barnathan, president of ABC's Broadcast and Engineering. Cameras had to be flown in some instances by helicopter to some of the most precarious positions you could ever imagine. Probably, though, none as awesome as locating this one on top of the 90-meter jump. Drifting across the landscape there, where the opening ceremonies were held, to this position. You can see just standing on a windy day is difficult. And it's something. I know I went there and my toes truly curled just standing up on top of that tower. 4 days before it was to be driven to Lake Placid, one of ABC's major mobile units was destroyed by a fire, necessitating a round-the-clock cleaning operation, and all the other trucks and the equipment after.